Scott for Scots here.
Do you hear that? Bring the mic in close. That's not how the grass should sound. There's weeds everywhere in this lawn.
It's time to take action with Scott's Turf Builder Triple Action.
It gets three jobs done at once. Kills weeds, prevents crabgrass, and feeds your lawn so it keeps growing strong. Ah, much better.
Get a bag of Scott's Triple Action today. It's guaranteed, or your money back.
Feed your lawn. Feed it.
As if the McCrispy couldn't get any better, Bacon and Ranch just entered the chat. The Bacon Ranch McCrispy. Available at participating McDonald's for a limited time. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
The Purple Mafia, with your host, Paladino Joey.
Well, we'll see. The doctors would disagree, but what do they know?
So let's just say that you'll pay me because it's in your interest to pay me.
Is it worth it? I mean, you've won. Do you want to wipe everybody out?
I don't feel I have to wipe everybody out, Tom. Just my enemies. That's all. My father taught me many things. He taught me, keep your friends close, but your enemies closer.
These are wonderful things that we've achieved, and there's no limit to where we can go from here.
Welcome to the family here on Purple Mafia. It is Tuesday, September the 4th, 2012. This is episode number 116 of Purple Mafia. I am, of course, your host, Joey Wygen, or Paladino Joey. Dylan Richardson, of course, was kind enough to introduce me at the beginning, and he will also be joining this show. That's right, Dylan Richardson will be joining this show very shortly in segment number 2. Of course, this show will be split up into 2 segments. The first segment, we will discuss the Vikings' comings and goings, we'll say, during the end of the preseason. We'll kind of wrap up the preseason with that. Not so much going to talk about the games. We're really not going to talk about the games. We're going to talk about the cuts. We're going to talk about the guys assigned to the practice squad and acquisition, a small little acquisition or interesting acquisition of Jefferson from the Arizona Cardinals. We're going to talk about that a little bit. A.J. Jefferson, that is, a cornerback. Yeah, a little adding some cornerback depth. So we're going to have some conversation with that. We're going to talk about a guy by the name of Brian McKinney very briefly. So that's going to consist mostly of segment number 1. Of course, as I mentioned, this show will be split up into 2 segments. Sorry for repeating myself. Segment number 2 will, of course, have Dylan Richardson, and we will have our season preview. Yes, season preview of the NFC North, as we like to call it. I keep trying to say Central. Yeah, I've said that before. But, yep. We'll do that, preview the division. We will preview the league in general. We'll talk about the Super Bowl. Who's going to win the Super Bowl this year? Our picks of who's going to win the Super Bowl. Who's going to win the NFC North, of course. We're going to talk about that. Who's going to represent each conference and who are the 2 teams that will be in the conference championship games, you know, all that good stuff. It'll be cool. It's going to be good stuff. You're going to like what me and Dylan are going to talk about. It should be a lot of fun when he joins this show very shortly, or semi-shortly. no call-ins. Of course, this episode, or this show of Purple Mafia, is available on thesportstuff.com and on iTunes, of course. And Dylan Richardson is the executive producer of thesportstuff.com. And without him, there is no Purple Mafia. He is also a Chicago Bears fan, a very knowledgeable football fan, and a guy that, you know, is fantastic to have on this show. Regardless if he's the executive producer of thesportstuff.com or if he's just a guy I met at work, you know, it wouldn't matter where he, you know, it wouldn't matter. He's a very welcome member of this show, and he's a perfect fit for it. Hey, you know, we're going to talk some Vikings and Bears. Going to have some interesting predictions coming up with that. Yeah, it's going to be fun. I'm very much looking forward to it. I hope you listeners are as well. So, yes, we'll also, as mentioned, you know, all this, all of what's going on with the Vikings in general first, we're going to get to the Facebook page as well. Facebook.com/Purple Mafia Show. And, of course, on Twitter, at Purple Mafia Show on Twitter or twitter.com/Purple Mafia. I do believe I mentioned there were no call-ins today. The number is 209-736-7877. 209-736-7877. It is a voicemail. Do treat it as such. Appreciate if you were to call in. Mention what show you're calling in for, which is, of course, Purple Mafia. Statement, shout-out, question, comment, whatever it is. Yeah, it'll be great. As long as you keep it clean, it'll be you'll be more than welcome addition to the show. Very welcome addition indeed. Thanks again, guys. So, yeah, Minnesota Vikings. Yeah, I think we've heard of them. Well, we did our final cutdowns and all that. Very interesting indeed. I did mention, though, the earliest post that I mentioned, at least for this particular show, episode number 116, I was mentioning how the listenership for episode number 115 was alarmingly low, and I don't know why. I don't know if it's because people aren't happy with the show, or if everybody was busy with the state fair, or a combination of many things, the bad play of the team. I mean, the play of the team has been a little bit discouraging, I gotta say, outside of the Buffalo Bills game. But at the same time, you can't weigh everything on the preseason, can you? Well, maybe. But I was wondering, yeah, I posted on there, only got one response, but I do appreciate that response. I asked about, hey, you know, what's going on? This is the lowest ratings my show has really pretty much ever had since I started back in April 2008. Yeah, it's been over four, and it's been about almost 4.5 years now. Yeah, I hope it's based more on the team and people being busy at the state fair or something. Hope if there is a problem, somebody let me know. And yeah, you guys don't be afraid to comment on there on the Facebook page. Let me know what might need improvement, or if something bugs you. Maybe I'm too boring. I don't know. Do I need to spice it up? And if I do need to spice it up, tell me what you'd like to see. That would be very much appreciated. It sure would. Something is really acting up here. But as mentioned, yeah, Matt Emer of the UK says, the show's great, dude. Keep it up. It's just our team is an embarrassment. I mean, I can understand that's probably part of it. That's probably a big part of it. I haven't heard from a lot of guys. Anthony Batista posted on here for the first time in quite a while when I talk about the most interesting cuts. Yeah, it's pretty fascinating. You know, some of the cuts that took, well, not fascinating, but there's some surprises, we'll say. Not fascinating, but there's some surprises. Yeah, but Anthony Batista finally returning for the first time in a while. Wouldn't mind hearing from him as a call-in. He's one of the great callers to this show. He calls in as Anthony from L.A. And of course, on Facebook, Anthony Batista. First time heard from him in a while. Dan Taylor, obviously one of the greatest posters of all time on the Facebook page and on Twitter. Miss you, buddy. Hope you're listening. I hope so. Yeah, the numbers were so low last week, I don't know who was listening. Yeah, and it wasn't family members, I know that much. So, yeah, that's just a little nudge there. But yeah, I mean, the most interesting cuts, we'll just get to that right now. Yeah, I mean, Sage Rosenfels. Yeah. Sage Rosenfels.
Oh my god!
That was slightly surprising. Just a little bit, at least to me. I mean, to some people, yeah, Sebastian Balls, not on the previous show, you know, Colin was like, yeah, let's get rid of Sage Rosenfels, let's move on. And, you know, I don't totally blame that approach. I mean, I don't blame him for having that approach. Can't totally disagree. But at the same time, I mean, I thought he was a nice fit to put the current situation. You got almost all young guys on the team, including the quarterback position. You really want to go in the season with a complete rookie in McLeod Bethel Thompson. Yeah, he made the team. Joe Webb, who's just going into his third year. Ponder, who's just going into his second year. I mean, it's just like a bunch of teenagers, basically. I mean, they're just out of their teens in a lot of ways, most of those guys. Okay, they're 24 years old, but still, that's pretty young, you know. And that's it. There's no guy in his 30s, 34 years old in Sage Rosenfels' case. In a lot of ways, Rosenfels was actually even helpful with Brett Favre. Not saying he's more experienced or has more pedigree, but helpful. You know, he noticed stuff. Hey, gave him little tips. Oh, yeah, I noticed this, noticed that. Maybe tips of what the other team is doing. You know, other points of view. The guy's experienced enough to at least get an audience with Brett Favre when it comes to stuff like that. I don't think Joe Webb really could. And Joe Webb's about as unorthodox a quarterback as you've ever seen. He's about as unorthodox as Gray is with the Gophers. I mean, it looks like a couple of safeties playing quarterback for the Gophers and the Vikings. I mean, gray? Yeah, I don't know. With the gophers? Yeah, seriously. I mean, really, that's what he looks like out there. He looks like Mr. Raymond or something playing quarterback. It's like, okay. Speaking of Mr. Raymond, yeah, he'll be playing Sundays for a second season with the Purple. Mm-hmm. The Purple secondary very likely will be the starter as well. Yeah, we'll continue very quickly. But, yeah, Sage Rosenfels getting cut was a very interesting move by the Vikings. I do not believe he's been picked up as of yet. I mean, as of earlier today, I have been kind of away from the wire, we'll say, for the past couple of hours, except for a story that I just picked up before the show. Bryant McKinney, yeah, we'll get to that shortly. Eric Frampton. Eric Frampton, yeah. Gone. Eric Frampton, one of the special teams aces for years. He's a safety, of course. He's gone. That was significant. Chris Carr, looked on as a very significant signing. Actually, a lot of people saw him as actually the better player between him and Zach Bowman, between the two quote-unquote washed-up safeties that secondary guys that we signed. Maybe they're not washed up, but, you know, not washed up, but they had a decline last season. Chris Carr is packing Jordan Todman, but we'll get back to him later. But, yeah, a lot of people liked him a lot. He had a good finish to the preseason, but Matt Asiata did earn the spot, in my opinion. I thought he outperformed him. So, yeah, Asiata will be the third running back. Chris Jaguerre, again. Yep, Chris Jaguerre cut again, just like last year. Last year he went on the practice squad. We'll continue with the practice squad here in very shortly. Eight guys were signed to the PS, as we like to call it. McLeod Bethel-Thompson, not one of them, because he flat out made the team as the third quarterback. Anthony Batista, Anthony from L.A., kind enough to comment. He says, too bad for Eric Frampton. He's a great special teams guy. He will be picked up soon, and yeah, I got to think so. Haven't heard anything yet. If I missed it, I apologize. Maybe one of you will post on there saying, hey, duh, he got signed by the Giants. Come on, wake up. And it seems like a lot of our guys like to go to teams like the Giants and such. I didn't see Eric Frampton being let go. They kind of hinted that there's a small possibility he might be an odd man out because of a guy like Andrew Sandejo. Andrew Sandejo. Yay, I'm saying it right now. I like Sandejo, you know. No, it's Andrew Sandejo. It's not really not as hard as it looks. Andrew Sandejo flat made the team. He was kind of picked up off the streets late last year. He played with about two games at Dallas the previous year. Played four games with, I don't want to call them the Vikings, but they sure played like it, especially in the secondary last year. But he actually looked okay last season, Sandejo. So now we quickly move on to the notables that did make the team. McLeod Bethel-Thompson. Yeah. Yes. Are you guys happy now? Are you happy now? All of you out there, including Sebastian Balls, who was in love with him, but many of you out there are totally along with Sebastian in that. I mean, of course you are. And, hey, you think I'm complaining in a big way, like, oh, come on, why would you do that? I mean, I like Sage Rosenfels. I think young quarterbacks play better with a veteran around them. But McLeod Bethel-Thompson, well, you know, it's about time the Vikings got lucky with something if he were to emerge. They must have some type of opinion on the guy to flat say, you know what, screw the whole veteran quarterback thing. You know, the whole veteran guy to help out the young guy. There's something about this McLeod Bethel-Thompson, MBT or BLT, all these goofy BLT, but really MBT in all reality. There must be something about him that they're saying, you know what, we don't need any veteran backup or any veteran presence whatsoever at the position, regardless if that veteran plays or not. You know, the value is there. But, yeah, we're like, screw that. There's something special about this guy. We need to keep him. There is a reason why they kept him, folks. There has to be. As mentioned, Andrew Sandejo, another guy that there's a reason why he's on the team. He can play. He can play. Matt Asiata can play. Stephen Burton, wide receiver, made the team. That's right. Seventh round pick, Stephen Burton, made the team. He was impressive in the preseason. Not amazing, but certainly good enough to make the team, apparently. Devin Aroma Shadu made the team. Yes, sir. A lot of people thought he might be a cap casualty and that Arsenault would make the team. Emmanuel Arsenault would make the team because they do not have to commit the contract to him, where Devin Aroma Shadu, who has the coolest name in the history of the NFL. I love that name, Devin Aroma Shadu, and I actually like the player, too, if you'd catch the dang ball more often. Excuse me. Devin Aroma Shadu's contract is they have to pay him the rest of the year. Manny, they would not have, but they kept Devin anyway. So, again, there you go. Devin just beat Manny, apparently. Emmanuel. Audie Cole, not a practice squad candidate. He flat made the team. Yes, he did. Tyrone McKenzie made the team as well, along with the guy that I mentioned before, Marvin Mitchell. That guy is, he can play. Mitchell can play. There was no doubt he was going to make the team, in my opinion. Of course, all these are subject to change because you never know with the waiver wire. And, of course, the acquisition of the cornerback as well. Cornerback from Arizona, Mr. Jefferson, A.J. Jefferson of Arizona. Oh, yeah, that's a beautiful, beautiful second, really beautiful defense over there in Arizona. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, I better not even get started there. Another notable with the cuts, though, Guyton. Yeah, A.J. Guyton, gone. Seventh-round pick, linebacker, gone. Or not linebacker, defensive player, defensive lineman, let go. So that's slightly interesting right there, you got to say. Marcus Sherrills also did make the team. And a lot of people were wondering what was going to happen because, well, Jerry's right. Potentially could become a stud returner. So what do you need Marcus Sherrills for? He's not really that great of a defender. Well, I guess he's better than some of the other guys. So I guess they'd rather have him than Chris Carr, apparently. So Marcus Sherrills, former Gopher, back on the team again. I remember 2 years ago he was cut and then signed to the practice squad. Last year he was able to play Sundays because he moved up a little bit, showed more valuable on special teams, and a slightly improved defensive ability. Now Marcus Sherrills, for the second year in a row, will at least start the season on the active 53-man roster. And he will play on Sundays. Yes, he will. Yes, he will indeed. So now we are going to move on to the eight guys that were signed to the practice squad. Good stuff, isn't it? Oh, yeah. Isn't it wonderful? Of course it is. Jordan Todman, that's right, Jordan Todman, one of the, probably the most exciting one for most of you out there. A lot of people like Jordan Todman in the preseason, had that explosive last two games. Bobby Felder, a lot of people liked him as well. A lot of people saw him as a guy who could be a sleeper at cornerback. Bobby Felder has made it. Defensive tackle, Chase Baker. Offensive lineman, Kevin Murphy. Linemen, Kevin Murphy and Tyler Holmes. Tyler Holmes has made the team, or made the practice squad anyway. Defensive lineman Ernest Wusu will remain with the Vikings on the practice squad. Also signed to the practice squad, Tory Gurley. Well, he's not a Gurley man, apparently. And Chris Summers. Gurley was with the Green Bay Packers last season. That's through training camp this summer before being waived. Summers, a rookie, was cut by the Chicago Bears over the weekend. So those are the two guys that were outsiders. The others were members of the Vikings during training camp. So congratulations to these guys. Hey, there's their NFL careers hanging by a thread for the time being, but hey, their NFL career can and will see another day. So congratulations to them. The dream is alive. it is. I mean, hey, I'd be thrilled to be on the practice squad. It's a lot better than being it's a lot better than having to just go back into the regular world and or hope to sign with some crappy arena football league team and make better money than a lot of us. But, you know, 60 grand is better than a lot of us make, sadly. Very sadly. But, yeah, it's not even close to the NFL. In fact, it's just, like, not even, you know. It's about, like, an eighth. We'll continue. We will indeed continue. The Minnesota Vikings did acquire, yep, cornerback Jefferson is mentioned. We acquire him for picks. Conditional pick in 2013, officially. A conditional pick in 2013 for A.J. Jefferson, who has played 18 games in the National Football League, two in 2010, all 16 in 2011. He had 60 solo tackles, 6 assists, 1 interception. That's right, 1 interception, no return on that interception, but Well, at least he played in the league. He was undrafted, an undrafted rookie. He is 24 years old as of April 4th out of Fresno State. Excuse me. He, again, undrafted. Well, I mean, he's done something in the league. He's not completely worthless. Vikings obviously see some promise in him, at least enough. Conditional pick. Not sure really where to go with that. I can't imagine it's much. It's probably like a 6th or 7th pick. Maybe at the absolute best, a 5th. But I know they're not going to give up a 5th pick for him. It's got to be like a 7th round, 6th or 7th round pick. And then, of course, depending on his production for the Minnesota Vikings in the coming years here, at least the coming year in general, it's going to be, he's a depth pick. I guess he replaces Chris Carr, really, more than Marcus Sherrills. Maybe Marcus Sherrills could be in trouble yet. It's all yet to be seen here, yet to be determined, as we like to say. Yeah, a lot of people really talking about McLeod Bethel-Thompson, boy. All over the place. Brent Jacobson, yep, haven't heard from him in a little while, but he very, very, very excited about Bethel-Thompson as well. They're a very nice post by Brent Jacobson. This is about He says, after watching preseason game number 4, I am impressed with McLeod Bethel-Thompson. McThompson's arm, but I would be a bit surprised if he makes the team over Joe Webb. That's observation number 1, apparently. His observation number 2, he says, replacement refs suck. Yeah. Can't disagree there. Observation number 3, Jordan Todman is wicked fast. Well, he's on the practice squad. Observation number 4, make it end. Memo to Goodell and the owners, get the real refs back before week 1. Observation number 5, I still want Plaxico Burress. Observation number 6, I love the Paul Allen Pete Bursich simulcast. I wish we could have the simulcast in the regular season, especially instead of Joe Bleep, or Buck, so instead of Joe F-word, basically, and Troy Dallas Cowgirl Buttkisser Aikman. Yeah, can't disagree with most of that. Yeah. I love the simulcast. Yeah, I love it. I mean, that was spectacular. Paul Allen and Pete Bursich, to be able to see it on TV and for the audio to be, in sync with the video, finally, because obviously the radio and the television are different. Oh, to see it in sync with Paul Allen and Pete Bursich, that was great. Paul Allen is a wonderful radio voice in the Minnesota Vikings. He really is. Fantastic. I wish they could do that. But, I guess that ain't going to happen anytime soon, that's for sure. Sebastian Ball's celebrating. All capital letters. Bethel-Thompson over Rosenfels. It's like, yep. Yeah, it happened. It's the real thing, and we'll see what happens. I hope it works out. Sebastian Ball says, sorry, Ponder. I know you're awesome, but I wouldn't mind seeing Bethel-Thompson playing in a couple games this year, or seeing a couple games this year. He says I think, my comment to Ball, Sebastian, was, I think Bethel-Thompson's a bit raw. He says so was Brady as a 6th-round pick back in the day. It would be nice if the Vikings could pull off a miracle. It really would. And, Bethel-Thompson was not drafted, as Sebastian wanted to make note of that and have a little chuckle there. He says that Rosenfels, longtime burnout in the NFL, got a contract extension and then loses his job to an undrafted rookie. Yeah. And, of course, yep. MBT, McLeod Bethel-Thompson, was out of Sacramento State. Yeah, Sacramento State. It's like, say that again? Yeah. Not really much known there. Tom Brady was, of course, out of Michigan. That's a slightly well-known school, I would say. Just slightly. People have heard of it. Forgive me if there was any chop of the audio there. I hope not. But, congratulations to MBT. How can you not be happy about that? Honestly, pretty cool. Man. It's some good stuff. That's about it with the comments. It's been fairly inactive, but those of you that did post, thank you so very much. Thank you so very much indeed. That's very welcome. you know, a couple of new guys joining. Thank you very much. I do appreciate it. Welcome aboard. I hope more of you guys do join. Again, facebook.com/Purple Mafia Show. Hop on board. You're more than welcome to do so. So that pretty much concludes the Facebook page part of the show. So let's get to Brian McKinney. Yep, I was ranting about him earlier on the page. Well, not really ranting about him too much. Mostly on Twitter, actually. I should get there really quick. But, yeah, I was saying Brian McKinney's a joke. He was basically saying on his Twitter account that it's over. He's gone. Time to move on. Because Brian McKinney, yeah, that's right. Brian McKinney showed up into camp out of shape.
Man, you think I'm going to put myself through that again?
Yeah, how surprised are you? Yeah, are you surprised? No. And, yeah, that's why I made fun of him on a recent show with, I believe it was the most recent show, if I remember correctly, or was it during the training camp show? Actually, I think it was, yeah. It was a training camp show when, former Viking Chuck Foreman, former Viking running back Chuck Foreman was just flat making fun of McKinney, calling him a mama's boy, and that, hey, I don't feel bad for him. I'm not concerned about him at all. Screw him, basically. Like, the guy's a joke. Yeah, he is a joke. And it was cool to hear Foreman be so wordy about him. But then again, that's who Foreman is. That's who he'll always be. Justin in Rochester. Very, very cool guy. Comments about when I simply said Brian McKinney is a joke. And, of course, Justin knows why. He says, I hope he never plays again so I don't have to read about how he pissed away another chance. You doing one more preview show? And yep, this is it. I was telling him how it's going to be tonight, Tuesday night. Yep, recording it. Yep. I was commenting, yeah, I mean, I'm glad that he's, glad that, yeah, I hope McKinney doesn't come back. Indeed, he says, I'm right there with you. By the way, just listen to last week, to the two shows from camp. Thank you for the shout-out about 2009. And you're welcome, Justin, and you're getting another shout-out right now. Yeah. Thank you for listening. Very, very, very much appreciated. Welcome back again, and hope you're able to stick around this time. Hopefully the team doesn't scare you away. It scared away a lot of people. I mean, I cannot believe, as I mentioned, I cannot believe how low the listenership was last week. And it's not, I'm not mad at anybody. It kind of scared me a little bit, I guess. Just scared me a little bit, like, am I that bad, or is the team that bad, or is everybody that busy, or what the heck? Wow. I mean, I hope it's nothing I did. I hope the show isn't that stale and boring, and always looking to improve it. You guys are always welcome to post on either on the Facebook page or call in or Twitter, you know, tweet me. Of course, this is Twitter, Justin in Rochester. It's @JDay_24. Hey, it rhymes. @JDay_24. So, hey, if you want to, give him a follow. Good stuff. Thanks again, Justin. Yep. So, yeah, Brian McKinney. I was talking about, now that I'm still bouncing, because, yeah, there's a conclusion to that story. Yeah, it changed. It did. And I'm sure some of you know about it, some of you don't, because, well, but it happened just recently. The story changed. Well, it went from Brian McKinney's been released, it's all over. No, they resolved the contract issue. Uh-huh, they did. A day of back and forth. Yep, this is, of course, by Terry McCormick of National Football Post, so credit where it's due. Thank you, Terry McCormick of the National Football Post, for making this article possible. He says, after a day of back and forth and the possible release of Brian McKinney, they instead agree to a rework deal with the Ravens, according to the Baltimore Sun. So, Baltimore Sun as well. McKinney was scheduled to make $3.2 million in base starting in 2012, a figure the Ravens were not comfortable with. At one point in the day, it appeared as if McKinney was done, would be let go, and I'm paraphrasing, should get on with it here. He decided, decision made, I'm done, or he tweeted, McKinney did, decision made, I'm done. Instead, he agreed to a contract that lowers the base, but still allows him to make $3.2 million if he makes all his incentives. So, yeah, McKinney is in need of a payday because he owes $4.5 million to pro player funding that is coming directly out of his checks each week. Ouch. He missed a payment on the loan after the Minnesota Vikings released him and making him in default. Wow, wow, wow. However, a new payment plan has been arranged to pay the $4.5 million back. You know, Bryant, Bryant, you are a lucky son of a gun. You really are. You are very lucky. And yes, when we get to talk to Dylan Richardson very shortly, this is a foreshadow that I'm going to give you. I'm going to be talking very high about the Baltimore Ravens in the next few minutes. Oh, yeah. That is a foreshadowing of what we are going to talk about, Dylan Richardson. We are also going to talk fairly highly about the Chicago Bears as well. And I'm sorry, those of you out there that might be annoyed with me for being so kind to the Chicago Bears. And no, it's not because that's Dylan Richardson's team. It's because I like the moves they make. They have been making some good moves. Years ago, they didn't do jack squat, actually. And I hated what Steve Walsh did when he came in here and beat the Minnesota Vikings. Oh, that pissed me off. Back in 2004, or excuse me, 94. Yeah, I'm that old. Yes, 94. It seems like 2004, but it's 94. Yeah. When the Warren Moon-led Vikings that I thought were going to go all the way got beat by Steve freaking Walsh of the Bears that year in the first round and got destroyed. Yeah. So, no, it's not all love for the Bears, but I enjoy Minnesota and Chicago, especially in the Metrodome. It's a fun rivalry, and I enjoy what the Bears have put together. Yeah. So, if there's nothing else, and I don't believe there is, it is time to get to that NFC North preview, NFL preview, and of course, we'll continue talking about these Minnesota Vikings. Yeah, I think we should continue talking about them, don't you? Indeed. We will be back right after this with none other than Dylan Richardson. And we are back here on Purple Mafia episode number 116. And as mentioned, Dylan Richardson, yes, that's right, the man, Dylan Richardson, has joined Purple Mafia once again. Welcome aboard, Dylan.
Oh, thanks for having me. But I think you're boosting up for, you know, for no reason. But, you know, it's good to get back in the game. I love listening to Purple Mafia. I'm one of your mods there on Facebook and everything. And sometimes I forget to write that this is, you know, Dylan, you know, so they don't confuse me with you and you with me. Cause you know how Facebook, the admins will post as, you know, Purple Mafia. But yeah, that's me. And I'm happy to join the show, Joey. It's a quality broadcast and I love listening to it.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I really appreciate you allowing me to be a part of things on the sportsstuff.com. Of course, the executive producer is, yep, this guy, Dylan Richardson. Yes, sir. Yeah, that is one of the funny things about Facebook, though. Yeah, I mean, I believe they just recently made a change where you can change like it to your name if you want to, but that's like a side topic, I suppose.
Not available for just mobile yet, but I have seen it.
Oh, that's
on
right.
The site. Yeah, a lot of times I'm on mobile doing whatever, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, me too. Sometimes you have to. That's the only way you can get on, you know, sometimes. It's too much going on out there. Yeah, but speaking of which, yeah, the Vikings have a lot going on. The Bears have a lot going on. Dylan Richardson, a well-known Bears fan. You can see in his photograph on there.
Don't hold that against me, though, Vikings fans, because I love football. And divisional rivalries, I think, are awesome. And this division this year, as I thought last year, is the new NFC East. This division has got top-notch teams from top to bottom, and it's kind of a crapshoot this year.
That's the cool part. This is a great division. The NFC North, as I keep mentioning on previous shows, you probably heard, I sometimes said NFC Central. I'm still stuck in the past, but yeah, as we probably all are once in a while. But yeah, it's going to be a fantastic season for the NFC Central, in my opinion. And I really do, except maybe the Vikings. I don't know. Oh, NFC Central. Yep, I just did it again. NFC North. Yep.
That's what I was laughing about. But, you know, It could be considered the Minnesota Vikings going into somewhat of a rebuild year.
Yes.
Nope. I mean, you got some of your problems with Adrian Peterson on offense, and mm-hmm. you know, and I'm, you know what, I was going to save this for later, but I'm just going to do it right now. I really like Joe Webb, man.
Oh, look at you.
I really like Joe Webb. I mean, that's probably like every fan's favorite quarterback is number two on the depth chart. Just because he's not on the field doing whatever wrong or whatever. Now, don't get me wrong. I think Christian Ponder can definitely develop. But for some reason, it's like, I enjoy watching Joe Webb play. And this preseason, it was kind of fun, you know, when he was out there. I don't know what it is. It's kind of like that Tebow effect where you just get that feeling. You know what I mean?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, that's the funny part. He is kind of the Vikings version of Tebow, where you're wondering, what in the heck is this guy? You know, is he really a quarterback? Is he a safety trying to play quarterback? Is he a running back trying to play quarterback? But, and then it's like, okay, I guess we won the game somehow. Well, that's cool. We won. He completed 50% of his passes, but he looked good doing it. Somehow. So, yeah, he's definitely the Tebow effect. And as you were saying, also, you alluded to how the backup quarterback's the most popular man in town in a football town. And the offensive coordinator's always the least most popular man in the football town.
See, Joey, it effectively mm-hmm. only took me about 30 seconds to completely sidetrack your show.
No, that's cool. And, hey, you know, it's football's football. That's what we're here to do. That's what we're here to do. We're talking Vikings, Bears, and all that. So which NFC North, thank goodness I said it, which NFC North team should we talk about first? Would you like to talk about your Bears right away?
You know what? I kind of think that the Packers, you know, mm-hmm. I think the mm-hmm. Packers are probably the top-notch team in this division again this year. Especially, mm-hmm. you know, especially going in. We'll see if they get any more injuries at running back like they always do and
yes.
forced to pass the entire time, and a lack of defense. I don't really think that they've cheered anything up there, but we'll go in any direction you want to go.
I guess we'll start with Green Bay. I guess we can start with Green Bay. We can maybe do Green Bay, Detroit, Chicago, Minnesota, or Minnesota, Chicago. But yeah, I mean, might as well start with the green and gold, as I like to say. Ooh, yes, we can collectively say that. That's the good part about Vikings and Bears. We can both hate the Packers. That's the best part. It is a tradition that they have an injured running back dating all the way back to Edgar Bennett, like 1997. I do that a lot, too. It's just been an ongoing thing forever with that team, but the passing game, of course, off the charts. Any reason to believe that it would drop off at all? I mean, Aaron Rodgers, 45 touchdowns, 6 interceptions last year. The kind of season that really is a statistical anomaly, in my opinion.
You know, you talk about an anomaly right there. Mm-hmm. Here's a good anomaly. Cedric Benson. They think that he's going to be their savior. And as a Bears fan, let me tell you something about Cedric Benson. It ain't going to happen.
Yeah.
Whatever goes on, I mean, I know he's had, what was it, one good year with the Bengals, whatever. I mean, he was drafted number one by the Chicago Bears, and he rolls over on his knee and gets hurt. He's kind of an injury-prone guy. I know he probably stayed clean last year with the Bengals, but you know, history has a habit of repeating itself. And in that place, you know, I don't know if it's something in the water or the way that their running scheme happens, but, you know, like Joey had said, they've mm-hmm. had a problem at running back since 97.
Yeah, 97, yeah. It's definitely been an issue. And, yeah, Cedric Benson, I mean, nothing short of a Band-Aid at the position, I would say. Yeah, the only way you're going to have success with them is if your helmet's orange and has black stripes on it, I guess, to be honest. And that's another place where they've had running backs get hurt just a couple times. Boy, how weird is that? But overall, that passing game at Green Bay, though, that's what it's all about. Passing offense and not so good passing defense, I would say, traditionally.
Yeah, they're not very good on the other side of the ball. They kind of remind me a little bit of was it the 99 Rams, where it's just score as many points as possible and hope you don't.
Mm-hmm.
You know, kind of like Indianapolis theme, the whole Peyton Manning years. Gosh, that's weird saying that.
That too. Yeah, and they got Jeff Saturday, another addition for Green Bay. They got Jeff Saturday, but an awfully old version of him. What is it, his 20th season already? Holy Toledo.
It's way up there.
Yeah, that's kind of rare that you had a center at that age to a... I mean, as good as he was, you know, that, in all fairness, but at that age, that's your starting center. Interesting.
I'm going to pull out the Wayback Machine and see if anyone gets it. That's kind of like Jim Otto years.
Oh man.
Some of the younger listeners will not get that reference. Google it.
Mm-hmm. Google it.
Google yes. it.
Yes. Now we can say that. You can Google pretty much anything now. You could Google how to fix a car pretty much. But, very much. But moving back to the offensive side of the ball, Jordy Nelson, Greg Jennings, one of the probably the best receiver combination in the division, I guess. Outside of maybe, I mean, Detroit obviously has Megatron. They have nice tight ends and everything and on that club. But Green Bay's tight ends are okay. JerMichael Finley's kind of up and down. Tom Crabtree is a nice player. But, I mean, the passing attack, they're going to have to really rely on that. Does Green Bay go all the way? I guess we're going to have to get to that later on. because their defense is suspect. Can Aaron Rodgers duplicate a year like last year? Kind of hard to believe. I mean, 15-1 usually doesn't go back to back. That's one major thing with that.
You know, another key is going to be JerMichael Finley. I mean, that guy's kind of a beast. But if he's not available, he's not going to do any good sitting on the sidelines. You know,
no.
He's another one of those kind of injury prone types. And another guy that's had some up and downs on the other side of the ball is that B.J. Raji. He's another X factor. And it's kind of weird. Like, these are the guys that really need to stay healthy that have these problems. And things can go really bad really fast in this division. Anyone is capable of winning this. And it really, you know, all the teams, not just the Green Bay Packers, it looks like, you know, one or two injuries away, they could be cellar dwellers.
Yeah, very easily. I mean, Aaron Rodgers goes out. Well, Matt Flynn was lightning in a bottle, but how about the next guy? You know, Graham Hartnell? I don't know about that. Or Harrell, excuse me. Well, Graham Harrell, I can't talk. But
and they're getting ballsy because on the depth chart, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
They're really not expecting any kind of injury. And, man, That's gonna be something, you know.
That's the key. They have to stay healthy. And speaking of staying healthy, Desmond Bishop, well, no, unfortunately, he's gonna be out for the year. Unfortunately, with an ACL. So it's kind of like, where do you go from there? They still have AJ Hawk, of course. Clay Matthews, the Claymaker. A lot of people like to call him that. One of the best linebackers in the game, but that secondary still in question. Charles Woodson obviously is great, but he's getting up there in years. You can't expect him to be in his prime much longer, if at all, at this point.
And at most, he can only be one guy, you know?
That's the other thing. Yep, he can't guard other people. He can't guard three receivers or tight ends.
He can try, but it's not going to end very well.
Mm-mm, it will be a disaster. So right now, I mean, I'm looking for the Packers to win 12 games. That's what I'm going to go at. If like I want to make a, if you feel like a numerical prediction for the wins for the Packers this year,
I think you're pretty dead on. And like I always like to preface this, barring any major injury.
Yes.
I mean, you could say that for every team, like I was saying. Yeah. But yeah, I think they're at, you know, they're a 12 win team. I think they're. And, you know, I'm already going to shake it loose. I think we're going to have two playoff teams come out of the North this year.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. Yep. And last year we had three, Detroit, Chicago, No, there were only two. I'm, like, not thinking here. Excuse me, Chicago did not make it. That was a couple years ago. Excuse me. Fire me right now. But so now we'll move to Detroit. Well, are they your playoff team?
See, here's where, like, you know, being a fan of particular teams, and I think it's really going to be a toss-up. I think it's going to be a toss-up between the Bears and the Lions at that second mm-hmm. playoff spot. But, you know, like I said, anything can happen. I mean, the Vikings, there's always a surprise team every mm-hmm. year. The mm-hmm. Vikings could very well be that team. They could be sitting on the cusp. I mean, you got a second-year quarterback coming in. Toby Gerhardt, you really didn't get that great of a look at him last year. Looks like they're, you know, going to get a really good look at him this year. And he kind of reminds me of touchdown Tommy Vardell, which is not a bad thing. I like touchdown Tommy. So, but you know, the Lions. Here's another thing: does the Madden curse come into play? I mean,
It usually does. I mean, it usually does. Remember when they put Donnie Culpepper on there years ago? That was 0-1, and it didn't work out at all.
That was almost the curse of his career, almost.
Yeah, it was a
pretty
joke.
Close. Mm-hmm. It was pretty close. Then Michael Vick broke his leg, and Calvin Johnson. I mean, he is that guy. Let me tell you, if you got him on your fantasy team, you're straight. I had him last year, and it was good, like, shape. Whoa, man! At least for the first half of the season, I was winning games almost solely with him, scoring 35 points or whatever. But he's a fantastic receiver, and a lot of people thought maybe this guy was not going to develop. Because if you remember, the Detroit Lions, 3 years in a row, drafted three wide receivers.
Yeah.
Everyone was scratching their heads. What was it, Roy Williams, Mike Williams, and then Calvin Johnson. Mm-hmm. And it's funny that the later of the three is the one that succeeded the most.
Yeah.
Yet I believe he came out of that rival to – is it Georgia Tech? I can't remember if he came out. I think it was Georgia Tech, but I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Someone Google it.
Google it. Yeah, we're going to have to at this point. Well, but yeah, I mean, it's super scary when you think about our division. Well, yeah, Aaron Rodgers, 5,000 yards last year. Matthew Stafford, 5,000 yards last year. I mean, the odds of either of these guys getting that stat again, I'm thinking is a little bit slim to none, but that doesn't mean they can't get 4,800, I suppose. That's a scary part right there. Just really horrifying thought. I mean, Matthew Stafford at 5,000 yards last year.
Yeah, on the offensive side of the ball, you know, Stafford had a little bit of an injury in the preseason. I don't think it was all that bad. Mm-hmm. I haven't really heard any, like, major updates. But then again, you know, I'm not actively searching out Lions news because I'm not exactly a Lions fan or anything. So, but any little bumps, bite, and bruise coming out of the preseason has got a little bit, you know, it's got to be a little bit worrisome for the Lions. And another thing is Javad Best. Now, is it Javid or Javad? I don't know. It looks like Javad. Yeah, I've heard
all of them. Yeah.
I've heard them announced different ways. And you know, there's a guy at work that was like, I'm like, yeah, whatever, Terrell, you know, same thing. You know, I'm pretty sure that he goes by Javad. But anyways, he's on the physically unable to perform list, and I don't think he'll be able to play until like late October. That could be a big hamstring for this team because now they're going to have to go with Kevin Smith. And, I mean, Kevin Smith is decent, but he's no Best. I mean, Best had a decent season last year, showed some nice things, and it's unfortunate that they're not going to be able to use him for probably at least the three to 4 weeks or maybe even more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, and Javid Best, he's one of those kind of tweener-type guys where – he's not going to put up the greatest running numbers ever, but he will. He's definitely a receiving threat as well in that backfield. That's a huge huge key to such a powerful offense as the Detroit Lions. You know, you have Pettigrew still. I've always liked him. Actually, the tight end Pettigrew, the defense you have Ndamukong Suh. I mean, you can't really go wrong with that guy, even though he's I guess you can go wrong with him.
Yeah, if talent-wise, but as long as he doesn't get kicked out of games and suspended and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. It's like, please let the guy. I mean, keep the guy's head attached to, you know.
The guy is a beast, though. I mean, you can't deny that. But I think what happens with him, he gets too much emotionally wrapped up, mm-hmm. and winds up doing bad things.
Yeah, he's just one of those. He's like a Ron Artest of the NFL, you could say, or Meta World.
I don't think he's that bad. Jeez,
all right.
Man.
All right. I'm sorry. I'll be nice for the time being, I guess.
He didn't beat up anybody in the stands for tossing a beer at him.
Oops, yeah, that's a part I messed up. It's more like he did to James Harden. No, that elbow to the head, yep. That's more Indomitian style, right?
Yeah, maybe here go with an old man reference. You know, one of the guys from the Detroit Pistons from the Bad Boy era.
Yes.
Bill Laimbeer.
Oh yeah. I like that. We're staying in Detroit, so we're still on topic. That's the good.
There we go.
So he's a Bad Boy Lion.
See, as hard as I'm trying to derail it, it's not happening.
Rick Mahorn. Okay, sorry. Timberwolves explosion. Check it out, guys. Okay. Well, yeah, they could. Yeah, the show's always got its hands open to you out there.
Definitely.
So, oh yes. Jason Hansen to me is like that's another guy. He's been on the Lions as long as I've been watching football, which is kind of sad. I started watching football at like 12, 13. He was a rookie that year back in 92.
That's funny though. Those kickers they got the longevity.
Yeah, they do.
It's because they're not getting hit every second.
Mm-hmm. He's still there. And that's the craziest part about all this, which I've said the last couple of years because I always bring it up just in amazement. He's played on only the Lions the whole time. That poor individual. That poor guy.
He's seen the good and he's seen the bad. One cool thing is at least he got to see Barry Sanders play a playoff game with Rodney Peete.
Yeah, back in the early 90s, it's funny. That's when I started watching football, and I was thinking, you know, that Detroit Lions team, man, that's a really storied franchise, aren't they? And it's like, no, they're not. Whoops.
No, only Barry Sanders is storied. I think, who's another, like, name like that? Maybe Dick Nitrane Lane? Didn't Nitrane Lane play for the Lions? Other than that, I can't really think of, okay, you got Barry Sanders and... I mean, Rodney Peete wasn't the greatest, but, I mean, I remember him.
Chris Spielman.
Yes.
He's a big one. He was kind of like an Urlacher, you could say, back in the day. He was like a really, you know, elite linebacker, of course. And the Vikings general manager is his younger brother, Rick Spielman. Kind of funny how that turns out. One played and one is a executive, I suppose. Very good. You know, still in football, I guess. That's the good part. But, yeah, I mean, I like the Detroit Lions in general. The coach drives me crazy, though. He's a little bit, he's a little much. Like, when I first started to see Jim Schwartz out there, his first couple years, I'm like, yeah, I actually kind of like him. He's gutty. He does some tricks out there, some trick plays as well. He's got some balls. And then it's like, yeah, he's kind of an ass. Just a little bit.
Oh, the whole thing with the 49ers?
Yeah, that was when it came to full circle. But yeah, like overall, he just kind of seems like one of the more cocky coaches. But yeah, definitely the 49ers thing, that was a bit over the top. I mean, both of them were wrong, I think.
Yeah, that was, you know, you could understand the excitement on, you know, Harbaugh's side as well. But I'm not the biggest 49er fan, and in fact, one of my favorite. Okay, here I go off. I'm so trying to sidetrack your show. I'm so trying to derail it. Let me tell you this. Mike Brown, who is a former Bear, single-handedly defeated the 49ers. I can't remember what year it was. It was an overtime. He intercepted a pass, ran in for a touchdown. I think it was one of two games that he did that with that season.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously not against the 49ers. Well, if you could look in this room, I have a framed jersey of Mr. Mike Brown, single-handedly just for the one win against the 49ers. And I think I'm going to have to get more frames if the Bears play the 49ers some more.
Mm-hmm. That would be awesome. Yes.
Oh, yeah, that's silly.
They need to play them more.
But that is a silly thing, and I just thought I'd share that with you.
Back to the show. How about them Lions? Yeah, and yes, we're getting to the Bears very soon, and maybe 49ers, depending on where your predictions lead in the NFC Championship game. But
oh man, you're gonna make me break out tissue and cry, aren't you? Hey, no, but before we leave the Lions,
yeah.
this Kyle VandenBosch, man, the defensive end guy for the Lions, I think this guy could have a breakout season this year and make the Pro Bowl. This guy kind of reminds me of someone that you'd see on Sons of Anarchy. You know what I mean? It looks like he's this big biker guy, like just burly. Like I don't know how else to explain it, but this I don't know. I find myself kind of rooting for the guy. He looks like he could be one of those dominators on defense. So that's something that you Lions fans can take home if you listen to this show.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the calling cards of Detroit right now. They're very their defensive line is very good. There's no doubt about it. Of course, Adamican Sue, as we mentioned before, Corey Williams, Kyle VandenBosch. Yeah, even Cliff Avril. I mean, they got a nice D-line over there. They're kind of trying to be the Vikings, I guess. That's the Vikings' trademark, is the defensive line, except in 98 when they could have used one. But there I go, sidetracked.
Here we go. Here we go. Now, yep. Now you're trying to derail the show. Every time I'm on, we start talking about the late 90s, don't we?
I love it, yeah. I love it, though. I mean, it's good stuff. Oh, it breaks my heart, too, though, just thinking about that. Oh. But, yeah.
Anyways, let's talk.
Yep, sorry. Anyways, the Lions, to me... yeah, they're a bubble team, absolutely. Are they the sixth seed, the eighth seed? Obviously, eighth seed means they're not going to make the postseason, but yeah, they're a bubble team. I think Chicago as well is a bubble team, but I got a good feeling about the Bears. Yeah, and that's a little hint that I'm going to get to later on. Got a good feeling. Yeah, yep. I think I'm spoiling it already. So I guess we'll skip the if Detroit makes the playoffs part until we get to Chicago, which we can go to now. Yes. How about them Bears? How about them Bears?
Da Bears.
Da Bears. How about them?
Well, this year they finally have a number one wide receiver in Brandon Marshall, yes. Which could, you know, be the maker or breaker of the season. Also, you know what? They're not looking too shabby at backup quarterback. I think a lot of people will be, not thinking about what Jason Campbell did as a Raider until he got injured. He actually was having a pretty good year, and he's been kind of one of those castaways ever since the Redskins, dealt him or whatever they did, however they got rid of him.
Brandon McNugget. Ugh, what were they thinking? Donovan McNugget. Sorry for interrupting. Yeah, go ahead.
He was a good quarterback when he was in Philly, but I don't know where stuff's going with him. But anyways, he wanted to be a Bear, but that's probably never going to happen, which that's okay. Another really good pickup that might fly under the radar for a lot of people is yet another Raider, Michael Bush.
Yes, yep.
He's not Reggie, but you know what? He is somewhat of a seasoned pro now, with Darren McFadden always going out. And so I've always enjoyed watching Michael Bush come in there. It's like, yeah, this guy's going to come in, and he's going to get 3 to 4 yards like almost every play. He's kind of a pounder back, which is a nice contrast to Matt Forte. I always screw up his name. But yeah, exactly. Matt kind of reminds me of, you know, the quote unquote scat back, you know, which is kind of bad because, you know, he took, you know, pretty much every snap last season.
Yeah, he did.
But it's going to be good for him, because they're going to have a change of pace back. Maybe he'll be, have fresh legs towards the end of the. Into the fourth quarter, and that's where you're going to need to really put your best foot forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Forte was outstanding last year, I think, for the most part. I mean, unfortunately, he got hurt at some point during the year, only playing 12 games. But overall, yeah, I mean, I I liked how he started, excuse me, now that I can talk again. The Michael Bush thing, yeah, I was going to get into that, obviously, but this is your club. Yeah. Excuse me. But, yeah, I mean, I love that move. Excuse me. I absolutely love what some of these offseason moves the Bears did. I mean, they shored up positions that they had to shore up because, well, look what happened last year. Cutler got hurt. Forte missed time. So what do? They bring in Campbell and Bush. That's, you can't really go wrong with that. Bears needed a number one wide receiver. Get Brandon Marshall. Yeah, I'm very pleased. I mean, if I was a Bears fan, I'd be extremely excited with the Bears offseason. I mean, not, it's not bringing in Brett Favre and Jerry Rice when they're 28, but it's a nice group of players, I think.
Yeah, and on the flip side of the ball, you know,
yeah,
Bears, the whole thing with Urlacher, well, I'll tell you this. Look for them next season. They have a number one pick, right? They didn't trade it away. If they have a round one pick, they're probably going to get a middle linebacker. Yeah, just because this whole thing with Brian Urlacher, you know, he's kind of the heart of that defense, but I don't know if they're going to need a triple bypass by the end of the season because he, you know, he's a tough guy. I'll give him that. He's a tough guy, but his body is now starting to fail him even more and more. I mean, he missed almost an entire season with the neck, which, you know, you got to, you know, watch your body. Your body is number one, so you can't, like, I don't default him for, you know, I don't criticize him for that move. Because the guy's obviously a tough guy. He's got something going on with his knee right now, and he's like, I'm starting. You know, pretty much using some, what do you call it, testicular fortitude or whatever you want to call it. You know, but, you know, both sides of you know, the defensive line, Julius Peppers and Israel Adonijé, those are two tough cookies right there. I mean, they're going to, you get a little lead, like I'm hoping that the Bears can get this year. You pin these guys' ears back and say go after the pass, you know, they could do some damage. We could see some turnovers like 06, but, you know, everything else has got to fall into place with the offense. And this season, I don't know, most of you don't really follow the Bears, but this is going to be major rights, make it or break it season. Either he's going to make it or he's going to be gone.
It's going to have to be one way or another. I mean, it's Brian Urlacher's knee. I mean, it's Brian Urlacher's knee. Yeah, that, I mean, I saw him get hurt in the Metrodome, actually, and it looked like it was an ACL at the time. So it's just like, it's unbelievable. I mean, I thought he might be done at that point because he was already kind of, as you were saying, you got to watch your body. He was already kind of at getting to that age where you don't know.
Exactly.
So seeing that, I kind of like, yeah, I was like, oh boy, that could be it, huh? And then, yeah, playing the tough guy card, there he is again, but it's really a risk. Yeah.
I really wouldn't be surprised if this is his last year. I would not be surprised. And I, you know what? Like I said, I wouldn't blame him.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a tough sport. He's been, you know, middle linebacker and a very heavy defense for middle linebackers. And, hey, stuff happens, man.
Yeah, but it's football for you. Major Wright, you mentioned. Yeah, it's like 3 years out of Florida. It's your strong safety. So he's kind of in a make or break year?
I think so. Mm. But, you know, the Bears are always hurting at that safety position. It's like, you know, Mike Brown, he was a free safety, but he couldn't stay healthy. And so they're kind of looking for a guy that can stay healthy. If he's that guy, you know, he's going to have to be a playmaker like Mike Brown was. That's kind of one of their playmaker spots. They like to do some one-on-ones or play like a cover one a lot, and that's only leaving, you know, one safety out there. If he's going to be the guy, then he's going to have to be the man and own that field.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those you have to hope for the best type deals. I mean, the Vikings hoping for the best with Harrison Smith. They traded up to get him. They're hoping to get him in the early second round at one point, and ended up trading up to 29 in the first round to get him. I mean, so we know a thing or two about you know, struggling at safety. Vikings secondary last year was holographic. It was, I mean, every time somebody would catch a ball on the other team, Detroit, I don't care if it was Detroit, Kelvin Johnson, or if it was, I don't even want to know, like Earl Bennett or something, you'd see Cedric Griffin 10 yards or so behind him at least. And it would be like, well, good night. Well, yep. I'm gonna go to bed now. It's 3:30 in the afternoon, but I'm going to bed. You know, it's kind of like that.
It's like a situation like, okay, Jared Allen didn't sack him. The ball's loose. I'm gonna go take a piss.
Yeah, like,
there's gonna be a commercial break after the PAG.
After the PISS. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, just yeah, and to be graphic, it was piss horrible defense, and it's. I mean, anybody...
Pardon the pun.
Just, yeah, exactly. Pardon the pun. Oh, yeah, I mean, just the thought of just you know, like when you're bringing up safeties and struggling, it really woke me up there just because of what we went through the last year. I mean, shucks, and even in 1999, there we go again. When the
Vikings, here we go.
There you go again.
We're talking about kickers in 99, too.
Ronald Reagan time. There you go again. But, yeah, it was...
Well...
There you go again. Yeah, that was the epiphany of bad safeties again back then. It was, yeah, there was an Anthony Bass. I don't even know how. I mean, yeah, I know the name. I just don't want to remember. Oh, I hope Harrison Smith is the guy. And for your sake, I hope Major Wright. Yeah, he just sounds like he sounds like a military guy, big time.
Yeah, huh? He sounds like he would be, you know, kick butt. Like, mm-hmm. You know, a Steve Atwater type. I'm Major Wright.
Yeah. You know? Get up there. Get in that course, sir. It's boot camp, baby.
What? Is your major malfunction, numbnuts?
That would be awesome. Yeah, he sounds like it. He does. It sounds like one of those movies or something. Oh, boy. But I do think right now, honestly, I want to say this. No, I'm going to save it for predictions. But this will be a hint of where I'm heading. The Bears make the playoffs over Detroit. Ooh, yes, sir. Yep, I said cold. It. Mm-hmm. Do you think so?
Man, I really want to. I really want to.
Mm-hmm. It's a tough call. I can understand.
It's one of those where I don't even really want to make the call because I think it's such a toss-up between the Lions. It could go so differently. For the Bears, I so badly want to say, okay, now they got a number one receiver. Jay Cutler's going to kill it. Well, now they got a number one receiver, which means now they know exactly who to double team, you know? Is he going to be able to break loose? I don't know. Is it going to wind up, is he going to, you know, rise to the occasion? Maybe. You know, and I haven't really had some, you know, good time to watch other than highlights of the preseason. So, I don't know. It's going to be one of those. I'll have to say right now, it is just like a coin flip for me right now with the Lions and the Bears.
Yeah, it's tough because you got Detroit's ridiculously good offense. Both teams have game changers on the defensive line. Both teams have that. For me, in the end, when you even those out, the game changers on the line, and, well, the Bears' offense isn't as good as Detroit's, but it's legit, I think. I think the key with Detroit is, obviously, the running game is light years ahead of Detroit's, even with just Forte, I think, honestly. But now you add Michael Bush, and you have insurance in Jason Campbell. I think that's the difference, is the insurance policy that they were able to bring into Chicago this offseason.
Listen to this, everyone. Joey's trying to talk me into it.
Yeah, I am. Yeah, and yeah, I dare say this. I don't know if you heard me say this earlier when I was thinking if the Vikings left town, who my new team would be. If, like, say the stupid legislature cost us the Vikings somehow. Did you hear what team I would be a fan of?
I think I know it's not going to be the Packers.
No. It would still be, let's just say they'd still be the arch rival. I know it's, listen to Viking fans, probably like they want to like bust the computer screen or throw their iPod in a toilet or something right now. But hey, I'm sorry guys, but if the Vikings did leave town, I would have been a
Bears fan, but now you don't have to worry about that.
Exactly, and kind of in NFL news there on NFL.com, they talked a lot about you know, the Vikings trying to make a bid for the Super Bowl to come back.
Yeah, and it will. It will at some point. It's just a matter of when. You know, it's, and unfortunately, the crappy part is they're not even going to get to start construction until next April, May, on the stadium, of course. Excuse me.
Now, did they ever have a Super Bowl there, like when it was Kezar?
92. Not in the Met. That would have been cool. But back in 92, we had it in the Metrodome, but not in the actual old Met in the, you know, 60s, 70s, and 1981-ish. But, yeah, 92, it was the first full Super Bowl I watched, and it was the most boring. I still hate the Redskins because of that game.
The Deadskins.
Yeah, I still hate them because of that game. I mentioned that in an earlier show, too. I'm so bored of that team. I just look at their, I don't like their uniforms. I don't like their personnel. I don't care if they have Montana and Rice. I still hate them, or I'm still bored of them, you know. I don't know. It's because of that game. It's like plastered in my skull, it's plastered in my soul for life. Ugh. Because they had like a third string quarterback in that game, pretty much. I can't even remember the running back's name. Was it John Riggins? Something like that. Oh, well, shame on me. How about them Deadskins? So, shall we talk a little bit of Vikings? I mean, obviously...
Let's do it.
Yeah, it's like, obviously I talked a lot about the cuts and stuff, but I didn't predict how many wins. Before that, should we say how many wins for the Bears and Lions? Because we picked 12 for Green Bay.
Jeez, I don't know, maybe...
Maybe wait.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't even know like what to say. Like thinking of like, I'd have to like go through the schedule and do math. You're asking a lot of me right now, Jerry. No, I think both teams could easily, you know, get in that 10 range.
Mm-hmm. Somebody's gonna get it.
Yeah. I think that second team making the playoffs gonna get 10 wins. But like I said, I can't really make a definitive choice right now. It just maybe after a couple of weeks, seeing where the Lions are at and really seeing where the Bears are actually at for real, you know.
That's the hard part. It's tough to predict, but since I'm like the overall host of the show, I'll go with
you
Bears. Yeah, Bears 10, Lions 9.
Ooh.
Well, yeah. No, like 8. Excuse eight? Me. Yeah.
So we're going to have a 12 and a 10, and then an 8 and 18.
Uh-huh. Yep, that's what I'm going with. And then the Vikings. Oh, yeah, you'll notice a little mathematical, let's just say, yeah, a little mathematical pattern here. And, yes, it's probably going to continue that way when we talk about the four. Unfortunately, right now, and this is not a rip at the Vikings, so fans, don't get mad at me. Obviously, we know this is a rebuilding year. We know we won 3 games last year. So, I mean, Ponder looked good against Buffalo. But other than that, not that good in the other 2 games, San Diego and such. Houston was the 4th game. He didn't play in that one. But San Francisco, San Diego. Not that impressive. He was okay. I'm still a little bit. And here we go. I'm going to open another wound for you. Should I say it? I'm still a little bit fearful. He could be a Rex Grossman type.
Ooh.
I'm sorry for opening that wound there, but I don't think he will be, but the possibility exists to me. At least that's how I see it. Obviously, Jared Allen still as good as anybody in the NFL, the defensive end position, defensive line. Outside of that, you still have Brian Robinson, the defensive end. LaTroy Guyon was very disappointing last year. In his first year as a starter, didn't look like a starter. And I loved him for years, thinking, oh, it'll be cool to see him as a starter someday. And he finally became that. Wasn't all up to par. We'll see how he responds in his second year. You still have Fred Evans and others. It's just going to have to wait to see with that. Not really all too optimistic about those particular spots, but the safety, Harrison Smith. putting a lot of eggs in one basket. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
You know, on the offensive side of the ball, yes. Devin Aromajadu, who is a good player, and I kind of want to see this guy, you know, step it back up again. He's definitely one of those talents that, you know, it seems like, if he just gets into his rhythm, this guy's going to be good. I mean, he showed some hints before of how good he can be, and it's like he just went to the land of nowhere for, you know, a season now. And it's like, hey, this guy was, you know, ripping it. And it's funny how some players can do that. Is it the change of, you know, a totally different system that he's not meshing with? You know, kind of like a Chad Johnson type of situation. Can the guy just not learn this system or what? But, you know, with Michael Jenkins and Percy Harvin, you know, knock on wood, Percy Harvin stays. Yeah, Percy Harvin, you know, stays okay. That is one hell of two wide receivers right there.
Yeah, at least those two. Devin Aromajadu, Percy Harvin. Yeah, Michael Jenkins. He's kind of Jenkins has some talent, has some ability, but obviously he's not going to be a game changer. I like Devin Aromajadu. I'm glad he made it. He was in a, like I mentioned this in, you know, the previous segment there, but I'll mention it again so you hear it right now. Is, you know, quote unquote live, we can call it. Some people were saying it was between Devin Aromajadu and Manny Arsenault. Because Arsenault, they wouldn't have to guarantee him the rest of the year where, you know, for salary-wise, Devin, they did. And some people thought Aromajadu may be a casualty because of that. But so I'm glad they're willing to take that on. I mean, the Wolves have money's never been an issue with them, but still.
Yeah, I think you got to go with the talent, too. I mean, if it's not going to be an outlandish amount of cash, you really... You have to go with the talent, and really, at that position, skilled position right there. I hate saying that, actually, skilled position. You know what I mean? That's like saying that linemen aren't skilled. Well, those guys, they really have to pay attention to footwork. And anyways, I'm not going to get it. But, you know, I think it'll be money well spent.
Yeah, I mean, in receivers, you know, obviously the skill is more like, you know, the up and down the field type such. My biggest issue with Devin Aromajadu, and I'm sure everybody else is, this is why maybe he's not an elite player. You know, he's just he's a threat, but he's not an elite player, we'll say, because he just cannot, he doesn't catch the ball that much. He's definitely been, he just drops footballs a lot. I mean, there were so many situations last year where the big play was there it is, 40 yard, nope, dropped it. Devin Aromajadu, this would be a 30-yard gain, maybe more, dropped it, you know. And it happened a lot. The passes weren't perfect, especially from the original starting quarterback last year. I can't say his name anymore. Can't remember it now. No, I'm kidding. He was so invisible. But, if Devin Aromajadu could be a little more consistent catching the football, then you might see a 1,000-yard season out of the guy, and I'm dead bleeping serious when I say that, because he's that good. But until he does that, he's just going to be one of those 500-600-yard guys with 4 or 5 touchdowns who looks damn good doing it, I guess. You know?
Hey, so on the flip side of the ball,
yeah,
I gotta say one thing. Jared Allen.
Yep.
Thank you. That's it. That's all you have to say. Jared Allen.
He's the only one, isn't he? That's the problem.
I don't know. Is Chad Greenway going to... I mean... what is... Is that going to happen, or...?
I've been a critic of his for a while. And it's not because I hate him, but I think he's... Well, obviously, he's... Dare I say, he's overpaid for his production, we'll say. He's looked on as one of the top... Or he's paid like one of the top linebackers in football. Does he play like it? Not really. It seemed like more than half of his tackles, I invented this term. No, I mean, maybe I did. Quality tackle last year on the show. I didn't see that many quote-unquote quality tackles out of the guy last year because that term, define it again, is it seemed like he was always turning around to tackle somebody because they got past him. It's not as quality a tackle as when you're actually able to force somebody backwards or stand them up. It seemed like people got around him way too much and got on my nerves, I guess, for a guy who's supposed to be as good as he's supposed to be.
You know, part of the reason why he's made so much money like that is because he was a first-round draft pick, you know? And yep. And that's maybe that's part of, like, my venom towards Cedric Benson, because I don't know if people realize that in 06, he made more than Urlacher, Briggs, Hester. He made more than everyone on the team except for, I think, Olin Krutz. He was the only guy that made more money than Cedric Benson, a guy that didn't even start, and when he did start, got injured.
That's disgusting how that works out. I mean, I'm much as we hate to say it, thank God the new CBA changed that, the rookie scale. They actually added a rookie scale instead of just first-round draft pick, first overall pick in the draft. Here we go, quarterback, Matthew Stafford, $60 million. There you go. Go play. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you know.
$60 million. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then you won't have a Jamarcus Russell situation, who is now out of football. And, geez, how much money did he walk away with? I don't blame Al Davis when he was alive for suing the guy now. I mean,
yeah,
geez, the guy just never showed up, never showed any emotion. Oh, man, we just trying to sidetrack this.
Oh, no, that's okay.
Let's get back on track here, Joey.
Joey, come on. Yeah, I mean, it all started from the rookie scale because, yeah, I mean, that's a rant we can easily get into when talking about football. It is. I guess we're on the defensive side of the ball. Running back, we kind of don't even need. We kind of already, like you alluded to most of that already. You know, we already know Adrian was hurt. He's going to, well, I'll say this quick, he's going to play. He'll probably be a backup or third down back in the Jacksonville game, I think. He'll be a factor in that game, but Toby Garrett will start because it's just he's going to have to right now. It's just wise, you know, want to overuse Adrian Peterson at this stage. But safety position, dare we say it, or should we stay on linebacker? Marvin Mitchell, Tyrone McKenzie, two. I think they're nice players that made the team. Marvin Mitchell, of course, was signed out of the Miami Dolphins. He started with the Saints, dare I say that word. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, seventh-round pick. He's a guy that's definitely made it in this league. He's no star, but he's a depth move. Tyrone McKenzie, same thing. Only second year in the league. Aaron Henderson. His brother EJ, no longer employed by the Vikings or any NFL team. Just kind of ignored during the offseason. At one point, looked on as an elite middle linebacker. Now, no. Replaced by Jasper Brinkley, who looked good as a rookie. After that, he was injury prone. At that point, obviously, missed all of last year. Now it's like, well, now you're the starting middle linebacker. You missed all last year, and yeah, get to work, young man. That's basically what happened.
Huh? Take the reins.
Yeah, it's a risky move, but it also shows the depth of the team, I guess. Nah. I'm thinking that Tyrone McKenzie is going to get some playing time, and it's probably a reason why Audie Cole made the team as well. Seventh-round pick, but a fan favorite already. Linebackers, there's some depth there, but not much. Yeah. Secondary, dare I say it, yeah, there's some depth there, but not much. Yeah. Your best safety is a rookie. The other one is horrifying.
To put it bluntly, right?
Yep, to put it bluntly. Yep, there's some Purple Mafia humor there, huh? You like it? Oh, Mr. Raymond's probably going to be starting. He's another one of those guys that was, let's say the word quality tackle is not in his forte. he was a watcher.
That's terrible.
Look at me laughing at my own. Okay, sorry. Yeah, he was a watcher last year on a lot of those deep passes, and then they always talked about how well, he emerged late in the season in the last three games, but yeah, the last three games when you were like 3-11, okay, great, I'm glad, against teams that were, you know, either totally out of the playoffs or already in, so it's like, yeah, that didn't mean anything. Excuse me, I'm on a rant now.
Bum, bum, ba, bum.
You love it? Yeah, Andrew Sandejo, there's a name that's, well, not familiar, but he was signed off the streets last year from Dallas. He's not bad. He made the team. He earned his roster spot. Jamarcus Samford, a couple of years ago, helped injure E.J. Henderson, broke his femur trying to tackle a Arizona Cardinal. I almost said Chicago Bear. That was a disaster of a game already, but that made it worse. Another safety that all he does is hit people hard. It doesn't matter if it was a 40-yard gain before he hit him, but he hit him hard, I guess. Hmm. Don't you just love safeties like that?
I miss Steve Atwater.
Mm.
even though he was a Denver Donkey, I kind of miss those hard hits that just was like, man, I can't believe that little guy can pack that much of a punch.
Yeah, sounds like Bob Sanders to me too.
Yeah,
Bob Sanders is like that. I like him. The Vikings didn't, you know, he was available and he was on the Vikings radar, but he went to San Diego last year, and yeah, I believe he's still there, unfortunately. That would have been a nice move, but of course that guy's a little bit on the injury-prone side, unfortunately. But a good football player nonetheless. Yeah, oh, the Vikings also acquire A.J. Jefferson. I mentioned that earlier. I'm not, do you know much about him from Arizona? Pretty much a...
Not a whole lot.
Yeah, he's not one of those one of those household names. Played 16 games last year. Very active, apparently. 60 solo tackles, 66 overall.
I have to say this. He must be good. He came out of Fresno State.
Yeah, that's the key, right? There it is. It's
Boom!
The future. Well, we got Texas A&M. That's where, I believe that's where John Randall came from. I mean, it's like one of those you never know, but the you never knows almost never happen. It's just you have to get beyond lucky with those. Yeah, we're starting a rookie kicker this year. That's exciting, I guess. It's risky, but he's got a stronger leg than Ryan Longwell. That's okay, I suppose. How about that quarterback position? Yeah, we almost forgot, right? Yeah, earlier you talked about Joe Webb. He kind of... what was the name we were bringing up that we're connecting him with?
Tebow.
Thank you very much. Yep. Heck yeah. Yeah. He is kind of a Tebow Ponder. I hope he's not a Grossman. I really, God, I hope not. And some crazy people might want to tell you McLeod Bethel Thompson is a Favre, where he kind of came out of a nowhere and was a backup for a year and then blew up on another team. He's kind of a wild card. I mean, yeah, the Vikings cut Sage Rosenfels. They did not see the need to keep a veteran mentor, that's the word I was thinking about, to mentor Christian Ponder, and elected to keep MBT, McLeod Bethel Thompson.
You know what? That is strange. Like, I just looked him up, and I didn't even know this. He's from Sacramento State.
Yeah. Yeah. Sacramento State.
He was...
That's pretty close to you, isn't it? Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's...
Right there, huh?
It's about a... hour and a half-ish, hour 15-minute drive for me.
Mm-hmm. And but, it's still probably an unfamiliar name.
Yeah, it was. Like, I thought maybe I'd seen it before, but, you know, I don't follow a lot of the college, but what I do is it's not really Sac State stuff, which I think they're Division 1A, but they're kind of like that, you know, they're a non-BCS conference, and they play teams like... Davis and stuff like that, which, you know, no one else unless they're in the area will know.
Yeah.
They don't really play. They don't play like Fresno State.
Or Louisiana Lafayette.
They might play them. I don't
Something
know.
Like that, yeah. Like
after that score with Alabama, was it Alabama that they played? After a score like that, they might want to lock them in on the Sac State schedule there.
Mm-hmm. Might be a good idea, huh?
No kidding.
Tough stuff. But, yeah, I mean, you look at the quarterback's ages, 24, 24, 25. The veteran, Joe Webb. And he's actually won the most games as well. That's a lot of youth at the quarterback position. Does that spell disaster or does it spell...
I think it's good. Better? I think it's good, man. You got a bunch of young quarterbacks to choose from. 25 is still really young for a quarterback, you know, and Joe Webb doesn't have a lot of miles on them wheels, you know. Wow. He doesn't have a whole lot of wear and tear, so he's not considered a high mileage quarterback yet.
That's good.
And the same thing with Christian Ponder and, you know, the rookie boy, McLeod Bethel. What do you guys call him? MBT?
Yeah. MBT. Some people don't. Oh, go ahead.
No, is that what you guys like with Chan or whatever? I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's such a weird, or not weird, but such a fancy name. He sounds like a knight or something. Like Sir McLeod Bethel Thompson.
He sounds like he should have came out of the Ivy League, right? Like he played for Harvard or something.
Yes, yes. Or he sounds like it's an Ivy League school, you know?
Yeah, it could be.
I'm going to McLeod Bethel Thompson.
Oh, you don't say.
Yes, my law degree.
Would you like a spot of tea?
I would.
Tough yeah, shit.
Welcome to the NFL. We're going to dump on you.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, if you don't like Gatorade, you're out of here. Well, basically, right? But,
excuse me.
Yeah. I mean, it's an interesting move to keep him instead. I mean, yeah, obviously he does have the arm. A lot of people say he has the tools to be a good quarterback. That doesn't always mean anything. But maybe for once the Vikings could get lucky. Just once, please, at the quarterback position outside of Francis Tarkington. But, yeah. I mean, Joe Webb, it's funny. Yeah, like we were saying earlier. Yeah, Tim Tebow, because he throws 50% and looks good doing it. And gosh darn it, we won a game against like Philadelphia on the road. We've won in Washington twice, which doesn't mean all that much, but it's better than not losing, I suppose. even though we might maybe wanted to lose and get a better draft pick, but that's another story. Yeah, I mean, that's the good part in terms of you got youth, you got somebody gets hurt, you put in another guy, like, oh, let's see what he can do. Let's see what happens. Rather than, oh, great, he's out. Now we're putting in Bubby Brister, you know?
Jeff George is rolling out of his wheelchair.
Jeff George, yep. Oh, that guy was the gunslinger.
Yeah.
To what he was.
You know, I started work with, you know, a new company this year, and there was a guy, we brought up the topic of Jeff George. He said, you know what, man? You watch a highlight reel of Jeff George, and he looks like he's the baddest-ass quarterback of all time. Mm-hmm. But then you look at his stats, and you're like, man, this guy cannot win a game, it seems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there's a guy that had tools, at least his throwing arm, yeah.
Oh, yeah, the guy could throw it through a wall.
Yeah, the guy had the best throwing arm maybe you've ever seen. He had no movement, but the object is to throw the ball, I guess, to the quarterback. Yep. No, he couldn't win games, not often. Like in 99, he won games here, but certainly not against St. Louis. Oh, that was a harsh game. Oh, boy. Well, with no further ado, anything else, any closing comments on Vikings, Bear, or Bears, we could say?
Joey, I think we said it all.
We did, huh? Yes. How about them Vikings? Well, for win total, well, yeah, I'm going to just go with the pattern here. Packers 12, Bears 10, Lions 8, Vikings 6. Okay. I'm sorry, but I have to. But we doubled our win total.
That's right. It's improvement.
Yeah, I mean, Detroit doubled their win total. They went from, they didn't double. They went from 0 to 2 1 year, and it's like, hey, there you go. Look at them now. Now they're a threat, kind of. Yeah, I think we win 6 games. I think it's going to be similar to 2007, like I said earlier. I was going to say 7 games, but it's like, I can't say all these teams are going to win that many. It's just, you know, they can't all win 9 games and then the Vikings still win 7. That would be kind of weird. It wouldn't make much sense. But unless, I guess, our division's the best in football by a mile. I can't go that far, but 6 wins, I think we'll see signs of development from this team, signs of the future. We're going to see shades of the future from guys like Ponder, guys like the Josh Robinsons of the world. That's a cornerback we didn't get into. The fastest guy in the draft, actually. Vikings took him in the 3rd round.
But he's already had some injury issues here and there. He'll come in, he'll enter the league as an immediate backup. So we'll see where that heads. He'll be the immediate backup to Antoine Winfield, officially at left corner. Who knows? He's one of those guys, if he gets an interception, watch out, because with that speed, he could go all the way. But, yeah, we'll have stuff like that to look forward to. It'll be a year where it'll be about wins and losses in a way, like, yay, we won. But it'll be more of like, wow, I kind of like these young guys. They're not bad. That's kind of where I'm standing with that. But so, overall, 6 wins for me, 6-10, and probably an improvement going into next year, I hope.
Any improvement is a good improvement, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you have a win total for Minnesota? This is a safer one, maybe.
I was thinking more like 5.
Yeah.
I hate to do it to you, man, but I was thinking more about like 5. But, you know, so many things can go right or wrong in the NFL. Mm-hmm. This could be the sleeper team, man. There's always one.
Yeah, I mean, the Giants.
Every year there's like a, holy crap, who the heck are these Bengals? You know, or holy crap, like, you know, the Lions, we're used to them sucking. They're a contender?
Yeah, like a real contender. Yeah, I mean, stuff does happen. You never know. The young guys grow up fast. Ponder, maybe he will blow up. Maybe the Buffalo game was an indicator of what he is. And he has matured, there's no doubt. Obviously, a guy, if his maturity level is already pretty high to begin with, a guy who got a master's degree in 4 years of college, that's not bad. So the guy has obviously got brains. Obviously, you got to transfer it to the field, but I think the ability's there. His arm strength has improved. His accuracy has improved. His presence has improved. So, yeah, I mean, just because we're saying 5 or 6 wins, or 7 maybe, but we'll say 6 officially for me, 5 for you. Just because we're saying that doesn't mean we are saying there's no way in hell this team's ever going to, you know, there's no way, there's no chance this team could compete. Yeah, you never do know. You know, and it's not because we're trying to brush things with a broad stroke either, like, see, we told you, you know. Uh-oh. You're blowing the Viking horn?
Yeah, I'm trying to. I'm doing it, you know, over my Pepsi bottle.
Yeah, there we go.
I can't do it. Let's see if I can do that. No, I can't do it.
Yeah,
Who am I kidding?
Easier said than done, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, I mean, eventually, we'll see. Anything can happen. I mean, this is going to be the wild card division of football, I think, outside of Green Bay, who's going to win it, unfortunately. So, we both have Green Bay winning the division. Is that a safe bet?
Yeah, reluctantly.
Reluctantly. So we could, real briefly, as we kind of head to the wrap-up here, what two teams do you have coming out of the AFC, or going to the AFC title game, or would you like me to say mine first?
AFC title game? I like the Texans, man. There's something about them this year. You know, the absence of the Indianapolis Colts actually being the Colts this year, I think that's it's almost a shoe-in for them to take that division. They got their first playoff appearance last year, their first win last year, and I don't know, man, they're looking pretty good. They lost Mario Williams, but you wouldn't be able to tell. They're so deep on defense. I just really like the Houston Texans to at least make it to that championship game in the AFC. On the other side, it's like, what team's going to show up? Is it going to be the real New England Patriots? Are the Jets going to make it? Is that defense good enough to carry that team? Or are they going to switch it up to Tebow and some miracle's going to happen? They're going to get their ass miracled to the championship game or something, you know? Mm-hmm. And the Ravens, it's the same thing. Is Joe Flacco going to be able to pass the ball? Is Ray Rice going to last the season? It seems like every year I'm making this prediction in one form of another. The Patriots making it. It's hard to tell. So I think the Texans Patriots is going to be my pick for that that AFC Championship game.
I like that. That's a fun deal. Yeah, and the Texans. It is impressive that they've been able to survive the loss of Mario Williams. That's a massive loss. They can make Buffalo a sleeper team over there in the AFC and a semi sleeper team. They're kind of a popular team right now, but excuse me. For me, I'm going to go with Baltimore for sure in that AFC Championship game. Absolutely, Baltimore. And I can't say the Jets because I kind of honestly, here's another prediction I'm going to go with since we're radio hosts. Rex Ryan's in his last year as the Jets coach.
Yep.
That team is underachieved, and they have underachieved beyond belief. They're overrated. They're not. I think he's done as the coach by the end of the year. There's my bold radio prediction for the AFC. Baltimore will be facing off or kicking off against the New England Patriots in the AFC title game. It'll be a rematch. I know that's kind of goofy, but I think it will be a rematch. Because the Patriots' strength is still there. I mean, betting against them is hard to do. Yeah, they lost Deion Branch. And no, the Baltimore Ravens did not lose Bryant McKinney.
They actually didn't lose Deion Branch. They cut him.
Or cut him, excuse me. Yes, yes.
So, I mean, that's like a whole, like, I guess that's like saying, you're not good enough anymore. Here, go play for the Raiders.
Yeah, that's more accurate. Yeah, excuse me for that.
Here, go play for the Raiders. Go find someone else to play for.
Oh, the Raiders. Ugh. No. that poor team.
All right, so what do you think about the NFC? Yeah, so do I. But they're just one of those, they're like the lovable losers of the AFC for, I don't know. But anyways, NFC, where are you going with on that?
All right, I am going with...
You're going to say the same thing I'm going to say.
I already know.
One team's coming from the north, right? Are you taking... No, you're taking the side. Okay, go for it.
Are you ready?
Two. I'm ready.
Two.
Really?
Two, yeah. This is where you're going to be a little bit... well, actually, you'll like it. Some people might not. Green Bay and Chicago.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Chicago. Man. Yeah, I have Chicago in the NFC Championship game.
Oh, again. Wow.
Yeah. Yep. I really like their improvement, like I was saying. It's the same points as earlier. Their depth, I think, is going to get them there. The 49ers, I think they are, I won't say a full-blown one and done, but I don't think they're going to repeat the what they did last year. Yes, nice young coach, very good coach. Alex Smith, don't trust him. Randy Moss, yeah, right. Randy Moss, yeah, that's like bringing, yeah, it's like bringing in Dennis Rodman to the Lakers right now. There's just no point to that. I think I used to like him, but I don't anymore. You know. So, and obviously Green Bay, best offense in the world. If they stay healthy, there's no reason to say they can't get to the NFC title game unless the Giants are there. But I'm not sure the Giants are going to repeat because we saw what happened last time. They won the Super Bowl, had a great record, and got beat right away. So that's what I'm going with. Green Bay, Chicago rematch of 2 years ago.
Man, I would really love to be able to say that, but I just can't do it, Joey. But we agree on one team, the Green Bay Packers make it a championship game. And I think on the flip side, even though it pains me to say it, I think the 49ers are going to get there.
Oh, nice.
I think they're going to get there. If you've seen some of that last preseason game, man, that defense is just something else, even on second stringers. And it seems like things are starting to come together in San Francisco. Like I said, I hate saying it, but I'm leaning that way. I'm thinking that the 49ers, you know, against Green Bay, I think that's going to be the championship game for the NFC.
I would love to see San Francisco in there. It seems like there's always some team that goes there that wasn't supposed to, we'll say, and I guess that's Chicago for me, in my mind anyway. But
and you know, a lot of people are going to say, "Hey, what about the Saints? What about the Eagles?" Well, ooh. I don't think the Eagles are going to mesh very well once again. You're probably going to see Vic go out. I'm just saying. Yeah. Probably going to see Vic go out. Yeah, and really? the Saints, you know, that team, you just, they got so many things going on right now. Like, they have a coach that's going to coach for 6 weeks. Then you got another coach that's going to come and coach the rest of the year. And it's like, everything's up in the air. Peyton's not there. You know, you don't have Reggie Bush anymore. You know, you do have Drew Brees, who's one hell of a quarterback, but I don't see that they could very well win that division. They're going to have to look out for the Panthers because they're an up-and-coming team, and the Falcons are always right there. Yep. Falcons are always right there. Matt Ryan, you know, those are two teams that they're going to have to look out for. Buccaneers, I don't know.
Maybe.
I don't think so. But I think the Saints are probably going to win that division. But I don't. They're probably going to be a one and done in the playoffs.
Mm-hmm. Playing one of the top teams, or maybe a Chicago or something. But yeah, I mean, Atlanta, they need to win a playoff game. Yeah, that's for me. You know, I think they need to win a playoff game before I can start trusting in them, because that's all they've done. They're like Dallas right now. All they do is get to the playoffs and lose, I guess. Dallas looking good also early on, which might trounce some of my picks. But who else am I going with here? The Saints, yeah, they're kind of, yeah, I'm pretty much where you are with them. They're going to have a decent record, but that's it. And the Eagles are the New York Jets of the NFC. One of those highfalutin teams. They always try to bring in all these players that don't match well, and whatever, you know. They're going to be just like the Jets.
Yeah, look at Vince Carter out of the league. Gone.
Yeah, pretty much.
He might not ever be back either.
It's been a disappointment, isn't it?
Yeah, he had 1 year with Tennessee that was good, and that was it.
Oh, Vinny. Yep, no more Vince, right? Mm-mm-mm. Yeah, I mean, that's Philadelphia for you. they've had good teams, but now they're, yeah, ever since Vic got there, it seems like it just hasn't worked out, even though they looked really good that first year he was there. But yeah, just like the Jets. You have Texans and Patriots. I have Baltimore Ravens and Patriots. You have Green Bay Packers and Niners, and I have Minnesota. No, I'm just kidding. I have Green Bay and Chicago.
That's funny how we agreed on one team on each side.
Yeah, we did. Yes, yes. We're thinking Packers, Patriots, or what? What do you have in the Super Bowl? The ultimate matchup.
Okay, well, here, I'll go out on a limb. I say the Texans make it against the 49ers.
Ooh, that'd be sexy. That would.
Yeah, I. I don't know. Maybe that's just like wishful thinking, you know? Because I think that'd be a cool setup.
Yeah.
You know, as much as I really dislike the 49ers, man.
Yeah.
I just have to go with what I'm thinking for trust my gut, so to speak. And I really like the Texans, as if you couldn't tell. Maybe I'll be hanging up a Texans jersey later this year, right?
Mm-hmm. You might be.
Bandwagon. No.
Texans and Bears. Yes. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I mean, you can. There's a team that I really, really like also, and that's an AFC team. And, I really like both of them, actually. The two teams I picked, they're probably my two favorite AFC teams. Yeah, and it's a rematch of last year. This time, from the AFC, I have Baltimore going to the Super Bowl, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, yeah.
They have been on a ladder. They have been stepping up every year a little bit better. And I've actually talked about this the last couple of years in my little playoff shows that I do every year. I love doing those. Even if though the Vikings aren't in them sometimes. Oh, they're so fun to like do all these little predictions and, you know, and comments and all that such. Observations, that's the word I was trying to get. But yeah, observing from semi-afar, I've noticed Baltimore every single year. It's a little bit better. It's like that stock or that mutual fund you have, maybe, you know, we'll say in your 401k, that slowly goes up a little bit each year. That really good, safe one. And I think this is it. They're finally there. I mean, they were a missed field goal away from at least going to overtime last year. I think Baltimore goes to the Super Bowl because, yeah, they stay good. Like, they'll lose a big game but stay good. That's what's the key about them. Or other teams, that's why I don't trust San Francisco yet, is can they stay good? We'll see. I just, you know, obviously they need to do that this year if they're going to. So Baltimore wins the AFC, and I want to say Chicago, how fun that would be, but I was almost thinking about it at one point. It's like, nah, that's way too splashy. Green Bay Packers and Baltimore will be kicking off in early February.
One of the better defenses against one of the better offenses.
That will be a forgive the word, a very epic matchup. Well, who do you have taking it, Texans or Niners?
Oh, man, you know, I have to follow with the trend, and that's mm-hmm. NFC team winning.
Mm-hmm. Of the Green Bay, yep. So no, not that, Green Bay, Niners, excuse me.
Yeah, it'll be the Niners, I think, because, I don't know, is that going to be number six? I'm going to have to hear crap from all these people.
It would be kind of cool in a way, but for history.
Yeah, I live in Niners territory, right? And so being here in the 80s and the 90s, everyone had the 49ers sticker on their car. And as a Bears fan, I just kind of looked at it and grunted. And, you know, in the 2000s, a lot of those bumper stickers and flags and coats and all that stuff just kind of went away.
Yeah, a bunch of bandwagon.
And now you're starting to see a little bit more, a little bit more. And I'm pretty much thinking that by the end of the season, where I'm living, it's going to be full-blown 49er mania, which sucks. But, but you know, hey, when you got the squad, you got the squad.
Mm-hmm. So. They do have talent, there's no doubt. Manningham, yes. Mario Manningham. And
so,
yep.
So I got the 49ers taking it all this year. Wow. God, that pains me to say it. But.
Oh, like back in the 90s, I was picking them every year. Like I picked the Patriots every year. And yeah, a lot of people are probably surprised I'm not picking the Patriots this year, but it's because I'm picking when you said the word trend. You said the word trend, right, earlier? Going with the trend?
It definitely is, man. I mean, I even picked the Giants to beat, the undefeated New England Patriots. Mm-hmm. I'm like, man, the team's on a roll. They're from the NFC. They play tough games. You know, it's just I think the NFC is superior.
Mm-hmm. And generally they are, but this year, like speaking of trends, for me is that's Baltimore's uptrend.
Ooh, you gotta go with Baltimore, huh?
Yeah, they're gonna be hoisting Lombardi.
Ooh.
Now, I mean, I was thinking this over for a while. Oh, but go ahead, sorry.
So if that happens, Ray Lewis retires?
Yes. Yep. I think that's the end of the line. He's been in the league. Was it? Is this his 18th year now? I think it's up there.
I'm out of fingers. I can't count that high.
Sorry, but yeah, it's a. but yeah, it's for me that team has. You don't want to say they don't have a weakness because that's kind of too nice. That's too strong to say. But at the same time. It's a team with very few weaknesses. You know, I mean, their defense is outstanding. Their offensive line is outstanding, even though Bryant McKinney's an ass and an underachiever. But they managed to restructure that deal and keep him there. Matt Burke is a great center. They got Michael Orr. I mean, it's like, dang, defensive line. They got all the talent there as well. Secondary is still good, but aging. Linebackers good. Some of them aging, of course, like Ray Lewis. But I have that feeling that this team is going to be champions. Yeah, I can see it happening. I love Anquan Boldin. You know, I mean, I've always liked him. It's a guy I used to always just dream about coming to Minnesota somehow, some way. He's just one of those guys, you know, he might not be the best player in the league at his position, but it's like for whatever reason you just like him. That's Boldin for me.
He can definitely take a hit to the jaw.
Yeah, he can. He's an intense player, isn't he? Or a tough player, we'll say.
Mm. So I think, I think Baltimore is the team. You have San Francisco, so maybe it'll be the Hardball Bowl after all. Maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
Maybe, huh? That's that'd be interesting, too.
That'd be fun.
Did they get rid of Cundiff? Yes, they did. They got rid of Cundiff. Remember the kicker?
Yep, Billy.
How could we forget, right? So Justin Tucker, rookie out of Texas, don't you dare. No. Or they'll be calling him that Justin. Okay, sorry. Justin with an F word. No. So are you excited? Are you going to be getting your 49ers bumper sticker if they win?
Definitely not. That is not going to happen. Will never happen. The only way it would happen is if it was like a bet or dare or something like that. But other than that, it's not happening.
Yeah, I was thinking that it would have to be a bet or dare. So like if if they won, maybe. No, you probably don't even want to do that dare, do you?
Well, I have pitchers, if you remember Jim Towers. We used to do a show called Cowboys from Hell, and I made a bet with him, something to do, I can't remember with what, but I have an Eagles jersey. It was an old McNabb jersey, and him being a good sport, as a Cowboys fan, he did wear that jersey, and I took a picture of him.
Mm-hmm. I still remember that. That was funny.
I have it somewhere. I don't know if I ever put it up. I always used it as blackmail, though.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you guys got to get back on the air regularly. Oh.
Yeah, that was fun. That was fun stuff.
I miss that. So fans out there, guys that like to listen to Purple Mafia, tell Dylan that he needs to get back on the air. Yes, he needs to get back on the air. And Jim Towers, too. Get back on the air, guys.
Yeah. It was some fun stuff. Yeah, it really was fun. I enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm. So with that, I mean, do you have any closing comments or?
No, I just, go to thesportsstuff.com like I know you all do. Check it out. I know that the message boards are kind of dead and filled with spam. I'm looking to actually just kill them and then make links to stuff on Facebook. But you can follow me if you like to on Twitter. Now that the NFL season's going, I'll be posting a whole lot more on Twitter, and that's at Dylan Richardson. D-Y-L-A-N and Richardson. No gaps or anything like that. And, let's get back to football finally, man. I'm excited about the season. I love football.
Yeah, I am too. It's about time. I mean, the sports abyss is over. That's nice, especially if you're a Twins fan. The sports abyss, having that end is a good thing. Oh, thank God. I mean, I'm thrilled to be back covering the Vikings again. This is your number. This is your number 5 already with Purple Mafia. That's weird.
That is, huh? 2007. Yeah. Time flies, doesn't it?
Yeah, time absolutely flies. So yeah, I mean, yeah. Do give that follow. Do follow Dylan's Twitter. That would be terrific. There's also go ahead.
Most importantly, look up Purple Mafia on Facebook. I love that interaction.
That's fun. It is fun. Facebook.com/Purple Mafia Show and Twitter, you also have @Purple Mafia Show. That's terrific. And yeah, we do apologize for the spam on the the message boards. I don't know where these people get the time to do that stuff.
It's all bots and it's just so hard to keep up on. Sorry to say, it just is too much. It's just way too much.
Yeah, it sucks. It's one of those deals where it's like, not how much you can do, is
it? Yeah. Probably just going to wind up nuking them.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, but it's just one of those things, or either restart them or link to Facebook's, I guess, huh?
Yeah, I think we're just going to link to Facebook because there's some pretty good interaction there on Facebook. So.
Yeah, and that way we can get things moving and... Well, there you go. There's an announcement on air about thesportsstuff.com, ladies and gentlemen.
Now you're going to make me do it? No,
nobody's... and nope, it's just there's a possibility right there. There we go. That's the rumor mill. That isn't a rumor is... go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
I'm sorry. One thing that isn't a rumor is that we do still have that phone line, 209-736-7877. Missed you guys this week. 209-736-7877. It is a voicemail, so do treat it as such. Mention which show you're calling into. This, of course, being Purple Mafia. And make your shout-out, statement, comment, question, whatever.
your voice will be on Purple Mafia show, and we will have some interaction. Yes, that will be terrific.
We're gonna make him an offer he can't refuse.
Yes, you can be on Purple Mafia. You can be a member. That would be yep.
But join the family, as Joey says.
Yes, join the family. Welcome to the family here on Purple Mafia. Oh, that sounds familiar. Wait a minute. Yep, join the family with thesportstuff.com. And, it's a nice family. I always appreciate being a part of this great website and the sportstuff.com community.
I enjoy having you on here, Joey. Your shows are fantastic. If you're a Minnesota fan, definitely check out those other shows of Joey's, Brave the Wild, Timberwolves Explosion. You will not be disappointed.
Yes, sir. At least you better not. No, they won't be.
And if you are, then the Mafia's coming after you. No, I'm just kidding.
Absolutely. Especially Timberwolves Explosion. That show has, that is a fun show. Oh, that is a fun show to do. I could just put my feet up and just go forever with that one. Oh, man. Yep, that's me talking about basketball. Mm-hmm. So, with that, we got we looking forward to this football season. Vikings, it's all about watching the players develop and hope for the best. Maybe things blow up, maybe they don't. But if the team improves, we head in the right direction, that'd be great. Look for the Bears to have a good year, I think, personally. Mm-hmm. Or the Niners, or Baltimore, or Green Bay, yeah. Mm. Yeah, we'll see where that goes. But one way or another, Purple Mafia will be back sooner than later. And, of course, we'll review that Jacksonville Jaguars game. Oh, and by the way, they will win it. And if they don't win it, the Vikings are going to go 2-14 this year. If they can't beat that pitiful Jacksonville team at home, they would go 2-14, I think, because that would be the biggest disappointment ever. They're in the same situation, also at running back. Maurice Jones-Drew. Not injured, but having to be the third down guy because of the contract holdout. Adrian Peterson, third down guy, is an injury. So Minnesota defeats Jacksonville. I think their home record will be good this year. I think that'll be where the Vikings' strength is at home. Obviously, for me, they will win the game just because they're a better team, and they just cannot lose that game at home. And that's pretty much all I got to say for now. We'll have more detailed reviews. Or previews and reviews for Vikings opponents in the next show and beyond for the rest of the season in 2012. So with that, thanks again, Dylan. Thank you again very much for being a part of this show. There is nothing like having you on board, Purple Mafia.
Oh, yeah. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, you're welcome. And we will be back, ladies and gentlemen, sooner rather than later.